first thing is to understand what is the background of understanding AI. So the idea is to really know how the extents of the actions that potentially when most of the reactions are not irreversible, in fact reversible. So what do we mean is basically whatever is the reaction happening, the reaction not end up completely giving C or D. You know, it goes to a certain C, comes back. So stoichiometry, what we generally call about is so we did not really say that C and D was formed. We said some percentage of C and D is formed from A and B. So C and D are products here and A and B are products. And it's very common talking also yields such that in the yield have you know this of this form and not complete of these substances because of this property of reversibility you know talk about deeply, we are going to really look at how much is the extent of a particular that goes through. Does the reaction completely form CRT which analyzes this extent of the chemical reaction? So for example, as in the slide, it can be seen that some reactions only produce about 70% and that you can calculate that outcomes. So it's maybe a state, you know, where there is no observable change as time goes. That does not mean that the change is not happening. The observable is pretty important. In observable, it's that we have nothing that can actually, you know, really make a difference in the concentration per, you know, reaction. So let's say, you know, in this equilibrium speaking, you can see a small bulb, which is a brown bulb. This is actually, so in which chemical equilibrium is something that we are trying to add. So what is a chemical equilibrium? Any forward going reaction of reaction, then we say that the concentrations of the reactants and products are the same, and chemical equilibrium is achieved. Now, let's understand what we mean by the rates of reaction. The rate of reaction basically means that what the reactant or product that you have before you know any you know the other side of the products is formed. So, for example, when we are talking of forward reaction, generally look at how much is the reactants getting decreased and how much are the products getting formed. And as this process happens with time, whether it is half slow. Now, we'll look into reverse and forward reactions in much more detail, but we are just trying to understand the overview of this slide. Recent simplifications are going to be the same. Let's look at some equilibriums. For example, you know, liquid water is going to change to gaseous water. Now, if the amount of liquid water is very, very, changes with time, then we say that the rate of reaction is very low. But you know, if the liquid water changes pretty fast in terms of the amount that is getting consumed per unit time, say that the rate of reaction is faster. Now, a physically clean water and gaseous water are in continuity with each other, are in sync with each other, where the liquid water is water as well as gaseous producing liquid water. Now, This is one type of equilibrium. The other type of equilibrium, where you have, let's say for example, N2O4 gas, which generally dissociates into twice of NO2. So, when N2 both are together, and the process of forming NO2 and NO2 forming back of N2 is settled down. We call it as a chemical equilibrium. Let's look at how this concept really looks like. For example, let's say we had a cookie store, and in a cookie store, we found that you have the cookies being bought. Let's say someone, a guy just runs into the store, and a kid is eating out cookies. We need to keep on adding cookies to the store, right? So someone has to prepare it up and get it back to the stores. Now, for this to happen, the rate of going forward, production or addition is the rate of addition of cookies to the store. So as the child keeps on eating cookies, we have to add more cookies, right? To replace the quantity. Then someone else comes up and he has some more of them. Support and so on and so forth. We keep on adding to our store so that the number of cookies we have in the store is maintained. This is called as equilibrium. So if we had decided that we were going to have the cookies, whatever we decide upon it, if we, as the cookies get consumed, so will we have to have more cookies being added to the store. It's called as chemical equilibrium, and this is what leads us to understanding of how reactions really. Now, if you really look at the rates, if the concentration of cookies is same, then the rate of sale of cookies must of cookies. And if once they both really turn not the same, then we will find and understand that the cookies are in equilibrium with in terms of their concentration. Yeah, so I can see that there are a couple of students who are saying that the volume is too low. Good to in here. There's small technical issues, but just bear with me. I think the volume. Okay. And nevertheless, I'm going to add up to video once more in the channel and YouTube view everything of it again. Okay, so that's not a try if I can. Let me try with this, and I hope the volume comes back. Okay, so yeah, there are a couple of them who are saying that the volume is really not picking up. Different my system, and they see the volume. Yeah, coming back to our presentation, we find that. So how do we really, what does it mean to reach a chemical equilibrium, at a macroscopic level? Yeah, so in our previous expression, when we have, N2O4 giving out NO2, we realize that, the N2O4 is actually decomposing into. Now, this decomposition basically seen through the brown coloration that we have in NO2 gas. Okay, so how does this brown work out? So N2O4 breaks down into NO2 molecules, which is what gives it the brown color. So let's look at the beginning of this some molecules of N2O4, and you can find that are the N2O4 molecules. So the white ones are the N2O4 molecules, and you realize that the the screen is there. So the N2O4 is colorless, and the brown ones are the NO2 molecules. So equilibrium starts getting established, you will find that the white ones get converted to the brown ones. And as more and more time passes on, the molecules keep on breaking through, giving us the NO2 molecules. Now, as the NO2 molecules are formed, you know, with time, their concentration, and there will come a time when, after which, no matter how much time you wait, the color does not really, change. So that's the position where we say that they have turned, come up to, at equilibrium. So you'll find that the entire NO2 is in equilibrium with N2O4. So that's the point where we say that now the concentrations can. Now this does not mean that NO2 is not going back to N2O4, or N2O4 is not breaking down into NO2. It's just that happening simultaneously in such a fashion that we don't have any distinction happening between either of them. Okay, so. To understand the concept of equilibrium, we need to first understand what do we mean by law of mass action. Okay, so what law of mass action basically means is that the rate of reaction is proportional to the product of the active masses of these reactants. Now, what is an active mass? Generally, active mass is the substance that actually is participating in the reaction. But in our situation, active mass most of the times we will take as the molar concentration. Raised to power of that number of species. Let's look at some examples. So, for example, in the example A giving P plus Q, state is proportional to K1 into A to the power 1, okay, because we only have 1 as the coefficient of A. But on the other side, E giving C plus D, we have the rate that is K2 into A into B, okay. So, depending on the different reactions, you will find that the rate actually depends on give us the product. In 2A plus B, you'll find that the A, the component of A is basically raised to the power of 2 because we have 2 going forward, right? So 2A plus B is what gives us the rate of reaction. So coming back to understanding what is active masses is nothing but your molar number of the number of species. In our situation, the molar concentration is square bracket. So when we write square bracket of A, it essentially means the molar concentration of A going forward. Okay, so that is the way that this can be written as in terms of active masses. We frozen N2O, which is at temperature. It's decomposes NO2 as well. But this color change stops after some time and NO2. Equilibrium is that point which the rate NO2 actually balances the backward rate of reaction where N2O4 makes chemical equilibrium happen. Okay, so the rate of forward reaction becomes equal to the rate of reverse reaction, which is when equilibrium is achieved. Okay, as the formation, more depth, the substance starts up and down into twice of N, but enough N to form. It cannot back to form N2. N2 keeps on, giving, N2O4 keeps on giving. And NO2 is more in concentration. The start giving back N2, basically, which leads to formation of the molecules of N2O4. Okay. When N2O4 formation is the double arrow is what shows that it is pretty dynamic, which means that the forward reaction is actually equal to the backward reaction. Both of them are happening simultaneously. Okay. Now, to really look at how these substances really work. So this forward arrow is what actually makes us understand forward reaction is, we would say that arrow makes us understand that this is a forward reaction going up, and while the backward one is can be written by a small half arrow. So this shows us the backward reaction, right? Now the idea of writing half arrows is to show that both of the reactions are happening simultaneously. So half arrows actually mean that the reactions can be going in each of these directions, but at the same time the second reaction also has to be accommodated in the process. Now come back to our one second. Now coming back to understanding the equilibrium concept one more time is that of A decreases to a constant, while the concentration of B, which is the product, increases from zero to a constant. This constant concentration mentioned that equilibrium is getting achieved. B, both of them are trying to achieve a constant concentrations which will be in action of equilibrium. Constant concentration through multiple. You can actually start beginning this. You will realize that the NO2 thing before is formed. So if you really look at the red line, I will find that that red line signal signifies that the concentration of NO2 is actually decreasing with time. Okay, so that NO2 concentration has come up from a large one to a lower one. But as you really find N2O4 also keeps on increasing, and at both time it have actually been constant. So the block of slightly grayish color that you can see here is where the concentration of both NO2 and N2O4 are stable. Okay, so from this point onwards, now if you look at the second situation where we start with N2O4, you'll have the concentrations of N2O4 much larger than the concentrations of NO2. So this is the point where N2O4 is it starts becoming constant after a certain point of time. But you'll realize that the concentration of NO2 also has increased. So whomever you start with, you'll realize that their concentration decreases while the other one's concentration is definitely going to increase. And the second one is if you start with both of them, then you'll realize that their concentrations will matter depending on whether they are further than equilibrium. If they are beyond equilibrium, then the backward reaction will dominate. If they are before equilibrium, then the function is going to dominate. Okay. Now, looking at this equilibrium, how do the values of different concentration of different substances differ? Equilibrium are achieved. Value. Find that either start with. Where we have only 0.2 and we do not have any concentration of O4. So if you really see this, the equilibrium concentrations achieved are 0.204. Equilibrium concentration achieved of N2O4 is 0.0898. If you really look at NO2 by N2O4 plus NO2 square by N2O4 turns out to be 4.63. So this basically is showing us how the equilibriums actually says that the value of NO2 square divided by N2O4 experimentally, all of them are more or less the same. What basically is changing is the concentrations of NO2s and N2O4s, and the equilibrium concentrations again are different because you started with different substances and giving the the entire compound. Divided by N2O4 actually makes the number to be constant, right? So this is constant. Now, how do you really write an equilibrium constant? No matter where do you start from, the final expression in equilibrium constant is seems to be the same. So, for example, for any general reaction, AA plus BB giving PP plus QQ, where a, small b, small p, and small q are the coefficients, and capital A, capital B, capital P, and capital Q are the concentrations of the substances. Please note, concentrations are concentrations at equilibrium. Okay, These are not the concentration where you started or where at any point in the entire system. These are concentrations at equilibrium. So once the concentrations are which are at equilibrium, you'll realize that the expression p to the power p and q to the power q divided by a to the power a divided by b to the power b, this remains constant, this is constant for a certain temperature. So it remains constant for this temperature and irrespective of where do you start in this reaction. Now let's look at N2O4 giving twice of NO2. Okay, now for this expression our equilibrium constant is NO2 square divided by N2O4 concentration. Okay, now look at the value of this. It turns out to be experimentally equal to 4.63 into 10 to the power minus 3. So A plus BB gives CC plus DD. This expression is what we call as law of mass action as well. As we have seen in the earlier situations, we are talking only about the rate of reactions. Here we are actually talking about the equilibrium, where rate of forward reaction and rate of backward reaction both are being considered. Okay. Now, if the rate constant than 1, then we'll realize that the reaction has almost proceeded to the product. And therefore, the equilibrium will lie more towards the right-hand side. When we say right-hand side, the flux is going to be much, much larger than the concentration of the reactants. Whereas, if you it has favored the products. But if the rate constant is much less than 1, then we'll realize that this equilibrium is going to lie much to the left, and therefore, it would have favored the reactants more than the products. Okay. So these are the different ways that you can, really work out with this, right? There are sometimes homogeneous equilibria. Now, equilibriums are of different types, okay? The large two types are homogeneous and heterogeneous. In homogeneous equilibrium, we basically find that the phase of the reactants and the products both are absolutely the same, okay? So, you have N2O4 gaseous giving twice of NO2 gaseous, okay? So, going to be the same in the gaseous form. Now, if we write an expression for them, the constant can definitely be written as NO2 squared divided by N2O4, but there is a different type of expression that we can also write in terms of their pressures, where we can simply write the pressure, partial pressure of NO2 squared divided by the pressure of N2O4. If you really see, and this was also one of the questions that we had in our exam coming up. So if you really see that the pressure, this one second, let me see. Right. So essentially what we have is that this is basically proper to concentration of the substance. So sometimes we might write it in terms of pressure as well, and this expression is then called as KP basically means is that the equilibrium constant in terms of pressure, and KC means equilibrium constant in terms of in cases KP may not be equal to KC, of course, because it's in terms of pressure and the second is in terms of concentration, so their values have to be different, but both of them can actually help you understand equilibrium in much better fashion, right? Now, you'll also realize that they can both be related to each other in terms of Kp being equal to Kc into Rt to delta n. How basically happens is, if I may have to, let me do with so you'll realize that one quick second. So if you really see, we all have been knowing, we know that PV is equal to nRT, and in this if we divide n by v, this is nothing but it turns out to be our concentration. So P into n by v into RT is nothing but CRT, right? So when we write of A in concentrations of B, divided by maybe concentration of P and concentration of Q, whatever it is, You can also write this in terms of partial pressures of P, but if you have to do that, then this C has to be written of P. Okay? So this is PA by RT, and we can write CB also as PB by RT, write CP as PP by RT, and so on and so forth, right? Similarly, the last one is PQ by RT. Now, you'll realize that you end up doing an expression which is PA into PB divided by PP in, into PQ, and this expression is nothing but KP for us, okay? While you'll realize that this RT turns out to be, you know, delta N. Delta N means the RT into power delta N. This delta N is basically the difference between the moles of the products, because products will be at the top and reactants will be at the bottom. So it is the products minus the reactants that will survive of RT, right? And this can basically be taken minus reactant. And this is basically taken in our, slide here, where we write this as RT is equal to, RT to the power delta N, where delta N is moles of gaseous products and minus moles of gaseous reactants. Okay. So it is C plus D minus A plus B. Now, in homogeneous reactions, CH3COH plus H2O, we will find that, H2O is a huge constant there. So, let's say this was our original reaction. Let's call it as KC dash. This reaction is not very feasible because H2O is a huge constant. You know, the concentration of H2O is much, much larger than any other concentration. So, you'll find that the KC turns out to be CH3CO minus into H plus divided by CH3COOH. So, here's a quick rule that we should actually remember. Of course, it's a general practice that we do not take up any units in the equilibrium constant. The units are summarily excluded. Although equilibrium constants do have units. For example, in this scenario, the unit of equilibrium constant is moles per liter. Why? Because the concentrations would be in moles per liter into moles per liter divided by moles per liter. Be actually taken out, so therefore KC will end up having only moles per liter in this scenario. Now, the equilibrium expression, how do we write equilibrium expression for some reactions? For example, here in N2 gaseous plus 3H2 gaseous, twice of NH3, the equilibrium constant can be written as NH3 square divided by N2 into H2 square. Okay, to a problem, to understand this in much more depth. The equilibrium concentrations for the reaction between carbon monoxide and molecular chlorine to form COCl2 at 74 degrees Celsius are CO giving 0.012 moles, chlorine is 0.054 moles, and CO is 0.14 moles. Calculate the equilibrium constants KC and KP, right? Now, we have been given all the concentrations of COCl2. The first thing that we'll need to write is the chemical equation. And it is very important to write the chemical equation in a balanced format. Because only in the balanced format will you realize that what are the coefficients that are necessary to, have this reaction happening. Now, you will find that Kc can be written as COCl2 divided by CO into Cl2. Now, if we add the reactions, concentrations at equilibrium, we will have Kc, which is nothing but 220, right? Now, in the same thing, if we write Kp, then we'll have to take up all the gaseous products and we'll have to write delta N as well. If you can see, delta N here is nothing but 1 minus 2 because we have only 1 mole of gaseous products, whereas we have 2 moles of gaseous reactants. So, delta N that we have, and therefore we'll end up getting delta N as minus 1. So, you'll realize that the relationship between Kp and Kc, of course, we'll write T values, but the relationship between Kp and Kc is RT to the power minus 2 turns out to be 7.7. So you see, Kc is 220, but Kp turns out to be 7.7, at the end of the, calculations. Let's look at one more example. The same, NO2 example, but this time NO2 is actually decomposing to give gaseous oxygen. Now, what is the equilibrium pressure of oxygen is what is being asked. If pressure of NO2 is this, right? Then you'll realize that the Kp that we can write is pressure of NO2 square into pressure of O2 divided by pressure of NO2 square, right? Okay. Now, if you really look at this expression, you'll find that the pressure of oxygen is nothing but Kp into pressure of NO2 divided by the pressure of O2 square. If we know oxygen pressure of oxygen 158 pressure of definitely given to us, similarly pressure of NO is given. Substituting the values, we end up getting pressure of oxygen 340 atmosphere. So expression two, how do we really deal with equation with all the format. Let's look at the heterogeneous equilibrium which applies in different phases. So you see that let's take one example, CaCO3 giving CaO plus CO2. In this expression, you will find that not in the gaseous form. Two substances are in the solid form, whereas one is in the gaseous form. So you'll realize that the one that is in the gaseous form, actually be creating a different concentration. Those are pretty low, whereas the concentrations of solids and liquids are pretty high. So if we write the expression of equilibrium, here we will get CO2 into CaO plus CaCO3. But CaCO3 and CO are very high in concentration, so generally we would neglect their change with time, and therefore we'll take them as constant. And therefore we have pressure, concentration of CO2, which is Kc dash into CaCO3 into CO. Now similarly, the Kp value will simply be the pressure of CO2 that is there in this equation. So liquids and pure liquids are not included in the expression for the equilibrium constant. Okay. Now this can also be looked at in the graphical format. So if you really see CaCO3 giving CaO plus CO2, you realize that CaCO3 and CO are being solids. They're in the entire equilibrium would not really matter, right? So the pressures of only CaCO3 and CO is what is going to matter, and you'll find that these pressures is what will change with time. So what we can simply write is PCO2 as being constant when equilibrium is achieved. Concentrations of CaCO3 and CO are pretty even, think of comparing to the concentration of CO2. The concentrations of CO3 or CO. Equilibrium, constant expressions. The first thing that we do is we write concentrations of reacting species in the condensed phase, they are generally molar concentration. In gaseous phase of in atmosphere, while the concentrations of pure and solvents do not appear in reactions, we only take the concentrations of the gaseous substances. So we will have all the Kp expression. Now, if you really look at the next, equilibrium constant is quantity, right? So, our questions that we write, you generally write constant does not have a unit, but as I said, it is it's customary that not really. Writing the expressions per se, and therefore you'll find the equilibrium constant expression is not something that we really. The next is when we quote a value for equilibrium constant, we must definitely specify the balanced equation and the temperature, because equilibrium constant is for a particular equation. If you change the equation, the equilibrium constant is going to change. Similarly, if you change the temperature, then also the equilibrium constant changes. The last is that if the reaction is expressed as the sum of two or more reactions, then the equilibrium constant for the entire net is basically a product of equilibrium constants. For example, we'll look at so how do we really calculate the equilibrium constant concentrations? There is a method called as the ICE method. In this, we firstly concentrate of species at the back action, and we say that if x amount of the species, one species has changed, now what will be the different changes in other species, and after that at equilibrium when we find the concentrations, we find out how much of x was really changed in the entire time. So let's look at relation of equilibrium concentrations of all of these species. For example, if you have Br2 giving twice of Br, uh, Yeah, so as we have BR2 giving twice of BR, then you know we would have the in Clayman constant for this reaction, let's say, is 1.1 into 10 to the power minus 3, and the initial constant taken is 0.063. Then the BR is 0.021 that we had taken initially. Now let's see how do we really solve for this question. Okay, so you'll find that let x be the change in the concentration of BR2. This BR2 will come up to become twice of BR. Concentration was 0.63 and 0.02. So this is called as the in the IC method. The change, let's say one BR2 decomposes, then twice of BR is formed, right? So whatever is the decomposition that happened, you know, twice of that will be BR, because per mole of BR2 decomposition, twice of BR is getting formed. Now in that scenario, 0.6063 minus x, while the BR formed will be 0.012 plus twice of x. Now, IC is where we write the initial, the change, and the equilibrium one below the other, and you will find that you know KC would work out to be 0.012, which is theorem concentration square divided by 0.063 minus x, that is 1.1 into 10 to the power minus 3. Okay, so solve for x, you realize that this expression is actually a quadratic expression. But that's okay, you know, you can always use the root of quadratic expression as minus b plus or minus root of b square minus 4ac upon twice a. Now with that you'll end up getting x is equal to x, two solutions for x, which is minus and plus. Now so minus 0.01105 and this thing. Now obviously if x is minus, it implies that forward, but the reaction actually went backward, and therefore at equilibrium you'll find that the bromine is actually minus 0.09 molars so what means is that that cannot be really negative, you know. So the only factor that we can have is a positive value of x, and 0.00844 mm is what the solution could be, right? So you'll have to take the second value of x, and you will realize that since the concentration of bromine was getting to minus, we cannot take 0.010 as the value of x, but we'll have to take 0.00178 as the value of x and find the concentration of bromine. Once we have found the concentration of bromine, you can be similarly found out by putting the value of x, and in fact we know that the reaction went backward to actually form more of BR2 than twice of BR. So that is the IC expression. Similarly, you know, for one more such expression, we have twice of HI giving H2 plus I2. The expression for, K equivalent for this reaction would be taking I2 product divided by the HI square, where we will have minus 2x giving plus x and plus x, because initially we only started with HI. This I have 2.42 minus twice of x, and xx at equilibrium. So therefore, our k equilibrium will be pressions of x square divided by 0.242 minus twice of x the whole square, to give you an expression of square divided by 0.242 minus twice of x whole square. Now this is actually equal to the equilibrium constant that we have, which is 1.26 into 10 to the power minus 3. So you'll realize that here we were asked for the equilibrium concentration of hydrogen, which is just x. So we just need to solve for x and we will get the answer for it. Also, a bit of rearrangement actually really does help, and you'll find that some mathematical tricks can be used here. For example, we can we can solve this expression by actually neglecting a few values that the expression that of these solving, taking out all the 10 to the power minus 3. So you multiply the entire expression by 1000, you'll realize that you'll end up getting 0.995 x square plus 1.22 into 10 to the power minus 5 minus 3x gives out 7.38 into 10 to the power minus 5. So you can multiply this expression by 1000 and it will simplify our calculations a bit. Again, we use the same root of quadratic equations to solve this problem. and we end up getting x in terms of 0.008 02. Now, of course, since it's a physical system, the concentration of hydrogen cannot be negative. Our answer here only is 0.0802. That's concentration of hydrogen at equilibrium. Similarly, you know, we can also solve it for the NO2 problem here. We can calculate Kp. In Kp, we'll simply write the ICs in terms of pressures, and we can. I would like you guys to stop, pause the video here, and actually work out this problem and see if you are able to solve this with Kp for this reaction. Okay, now moving on from here, let's say the K equilibrium is really small for a particular reaction. Basically, it means that it's not going to proceed. Meaning that the equilibrium concentrations would be the same as initial concentrations of the reactants. In this situation, since x is very small, you can, you know, always approximate 0.20 equal to 0.20 only, because that's what is really going to give you the concentration of reactants. In K equilibrium and initial concentrations is around 3 orders of magnitude or more, then you can always go for this approximation, and you'll realize that this approximation always works out to give you the solutions for this, you know, problem. You don't need to do much calculations, but easy calculations can really work out. Okay. Hence, you'll have to use the quadratic equation to really solve the problem. Now, again, looking at I2 and 2I, here we'll, you know, if you really look at the problem, we have to calculate the concentrations at equilibrium at 600 Kelvin and 2000 Kelvin, where the Kc for both of these expressions have been given. So the Kc for 600 Kelvin is given as 2.9 × 10^-10, whereas the Kc for 2000 Kelvin is given as 0.029, okay, 0.209. So having said this, since the Kc values are different, you'll find that we will have to write the ICs for the different equilibriums. The ICs will be the same, but we'll relate them to the solutions of different equilibriums. For example, in the first scenario, we will relate the I square to I2 to 2.94 × 10^-10, whereas in the second one, in the first one, you'll realize that it is almost there is a difference of 3 orders of magnitude between the initial concentration and x, and therefore here. So all we can do is we can write this as 2x² is equal to, so 0.20 minus x can be written the same as 0.20, and 2x² divided by 0.20 can be equated, and the equation can be solved for x. But for the right, for the second equation, which is 209, we cannot do this approximation because it will be very close to 0.20, and therefore our answer will go wrong. So the approximation can only be used if there is a difference of 3 orders of magnitude going forward. So in this scenario, we go through the quadratic method and we get our roots for our solution. Now let's understand what happens when you have concentration of two reactions working together. For example, A plus and C plus D giving E plus F. In this scenario, let's say the equilibrium concentrations are Kc dash and Kc double dash, right? So I have concentrations for Kc and Kc double dash, which is CD and AP, or double dash divided, that is equal to EF divided by CD. You'll realize in this scenario, CD are common to each other. So if we add this reaction, the net reaction that we get is only A plus B giving C plus E, E plus F. And let's say the expression for this is Kc. If you really see, Kc can be written as E into F divided by A into B. But if you really, also look at the multiplication of both of these, in Kc double dash, if you use the product, the C and D at numerator and denominator actually cancels out, and therefore the net reaction can be of Kc's of their individual reaction. So the equilibrium constant net is nothing but the product of individual reactions. So if the reaction is expressed as the sum of two or more reactions, the equilibrium constant of the overall reaction is actually given by constants of individual reactions. So at some more expression equations, this is that we have been looking from beginning. So N2O4 giving twice of NO2 will be divided by N2O4, which is 4.63 × 10^-3. In the reverse format, our equilibrium constant changes, which is N2O4 divided by NO2 square now, which will be basically 1 by K, and therefore 216. So 4.63 into 10 to the power minus 3, it has gone almost to 2.16. So when the reaction is written in the opposite direction, the equilibrium constant becomes the residual of the equilibrium constant of the original one. The reaction course related by substituting the initial concentrations of the reactants and products. Let's say, you know, we do not know whether the equilibrium is being achieved or not. What you will generally do is, you will find the reaction quotient at any point of time. So what is the reaction quotient? Reaction quotient is nothing but substituting concentrations at any point of time and seeing what is the product of the expression of equilibrium constant we generally have. So for example, you know, when we have QC that is greater than KC, the definitely is going to proceed to the left from right. This is because, you know, the products are more in number than the reactants, and hence the you know, expression has to go towards the towards backward. Similarly, if you have QC that is equal to KC, the system then is at equilibrium, and you'll realize good. So the reaction is not going to move towards any direction as such. The last is when QC is actually less than KC. We know that the products are less in amount than the reaction will proceed forward, which is towards left. From left towards right. This is the different ways to actually look at QC and KC. So when QC was basically QC has to achieve KC and therefore it will act. Now when QC and KC are the same, there is no net change, and when QC is more than the KC, the you know, the reaction has to proceed more towards reactants than products to get the value of KC that is necessary. The next you know, point of this topic is to understand Le Chatelier's principle, where we will understand whether there is an external you know, to the equilibrium. So let's say the system at equilibrium and we change some parameters of this system, then you know, whatever we change is going to you know, disturb the equilibrium, and what the equilibrium then does to nullify that change that we brought in you know, at this point of time. The here by external stress we mean that some parameters of the equilibrium, and change is what the equilibrium is what Le Chatelier. So how do we do this? Is we change, for example, you know, let's say we change in the concentration, you know. So let's look at this with, for example, you know, the N2 is the Haber's process. Now in this scenario, if we add more of ammonia, obviously the reaction will have more of the concentration instance now, and the equilibrium try to go towards the left side, producing more of that we have put in. So here's a in the time that everything was the same, the nitrogen, hydrogen and ammonia were equal. But suddenly added ammonia, so there is a spike in the green line here. You'll realize that the concentration of suddenly increased. Now they will try to, you know, balance. Now as that starts happening, the concentration of ammonia is the concentrations of hydrogen and nitrogen. So these are the ways that, you know, you can actually have the looked at. The concentrations of hydrogen is now improved from the earlier ones to much more than it was, right? Similarly, the nitrogen concentration also has increased. Okay, now let's look at the concentration. You know, for a general reaction like AA plus BB giving CC plus DD. In this general expression, if you start adding, you know, the reaction is moved towards the different sides. So increase in concentration of products, it's going to shift the equilibrium towards left. Similarly, increase in, if you remove the products, the equilibrium is going to shift towards the right hand side. So decrease in concentration of products, your equilibrium will try and shift towards the right hand side. Right. Similarly, if you add reactants, the equilibrium right hand side. But if you add products or you remove the reactants, the equilibrium will shift towards the left. So this is one way where you have you know, the concentrations of A, B, C, and D looked at in different dimensions. Either you change the reactants or the products, and it's an effect of both of them happening. Okay. Let's look at from perspective, especially in case of situations where you have gaseous reactants and products. So whenever you increase the pressure, with the fewest moles of gas will it will go to, right? So in this increase the pressure, less moles, and therefore the equilibrium will decrease the pressure, it will shift more towards A and B, because more number means more the pressure. So if you're decreasing the pressure, to increase the pressure, and therefore it will move towards the reactant side. Similarly, if you increase the volume, now since the volume is increased, you again need more number of moles. So you'll find that it will go towards the side which has most number of moles, which is A and B. Increase the volume, you'll find that it will go to the sides which has fewest number of moles, which is basically C. So this is what Le Chatelier's principle says, is that at equilibrium, if you do bring in any changes, you will find that the reaction moves in that direction so as to nullify the change. Let's have our system, N2O4 and NO2. The N2O4 system is where if you increase the temperature, you decrease this. The value of K decreases. Why? Because if you are increasing the temperature, N2O4 is actually a reaction which is favored by temperature. So if you increase the temperature, more of NO2 is formed, and therefore it is more brown in nature, as you can see in this hotter bulb. But if temperature, more of N2O4 is formed. So this reaction is favored by the increase in temperature, and therefore the K becomes much more as temperature, and because an exothermic process. Okay. Similarly, if you have an endothermic process, if you increase the temperature, your K is going to decrease. Decreasing K means that you will have less of products and more of reactants. Okay, so temperature actually matters and equilibrium for endothermic exothermic processes. Similarly, for decrease in temperature, it will be the reverse. Decrease the temperature for exothermic processes. Your K is going to increase because it will want to have more of the products. Why? Because it's an exothermic process. So you decrease the temperature, it will try to warm the system up, and the process of warming system is going to create more heat, but heat is created only while you form products, and therefore more of products will be formed. Okay. Now, this is a typical energy diagram for a catalyst. Now, adding a catalyst actually does no difference. It only increases the speed of forward and backward reaction. But having said the reaction simply keeps on moving in both the reactions in with larger speed. Having said this, there is a little change in terms of the concentrations, or the equilibrium does not shift. Only what happens is the activation energy changes. So it does not change the K, it does not shift the position of equilibrium, only the activation energy changes and the equilibrium is achieved faster. So you can see that the catalyzed reaction lower activation energy, whereas uncatalyzed has a higher activation energy. So catalyst lowers both EA for forward and reverse reactions, and equilibrium has another difference in the entire system. Okay, now we have seen the Haber's process quite some time, right? So we know that nitrogen and hydrogen basically gives ammonia, that is delta H, which it's basically an endothermic process of the formation of ammonia. It's an exothermic process. So you have ammonia. As ammonia is formed, heat is given out, almost 92.6 kilojoules per mole. You realize that as you increase the pressure, you'll find that the mole percent of ammonia actually increases. Why? Because as you increase the pressure, the system will want to go towards that side, which will have less number of molecules, which is nothing but ammonia. So increasing pressure actually helps. Similarly, if you increase in the temperature, the green shows N2 and H2, whereas NH3 red. So if you keep on increasing the temperature, you'll find that the moles percentage of NH3 decreases. But this process is exothermic. So if you are in temperature, exothermic would resist that. Entropy, they would want to have a higher temperature because they can absorb more of heat, but the exothermic they will not be favored by this reaction. So basically, if you really see, this is the one of the reasons why we actually keep on taking as much as possible while this process keeps on happening. because as we take out ammonia, you'll find that N2 and H2 will keep on reacting more because we are taking out substances from NH3 equilibrium. So let's see that happen. So if you change the concentration, yes, the equilibrium shifts, but the equilibrium constant does not change. If you change the pressure, yes, the equilibrium does shift. Again, the equilibrium constant does not change. If you change the volume, again, there is a equilibrium, but there is no change in equilibrium constant. But if you find that the equilibrium does shift, but there is also a change in equilibrium constant. So equilibrium constant does depend on the temperature, but it does not depend on the catalyst as a final one. So if you put the forward and backward reaction, the equilibrium does not shift, but equilibrium constant also does not change. So this brings us to the end of this presentation, we'll be sharing some more problems with you pretty soon, I hope this will help in understanding the equilibrium chapter. I would also, any questions, you please post it out on the group, and we'll try and address them. Thank you so much. I'll get back to you with the link on.